Guys, welcome to the stream. Hold on. We got my lovely guests here. You're gonna see them in a moment. Daniel Posey and Gina, how are you guys doing? Welcome to the stream.
Wow, Dennis, you know, I'm doing great. Mm-hmm. Gina and I, of course, dressed up as the remaining Lannisters.
Well,
at least, you know, those who are, well, we can't get into that right now.
Yeah.
Dang it. But anyway, I'm a little warm right now because there's a lot of layers going on. I've tried to give myself two breasts, but apparently I just have a uniboob that's right there in the center, and it just won't go. It won't go away. So,
you know, the uniboob is pretty impressive. You know,
I'll be like the lady from Total Recall.
Yeah, see, that's the spirit.
But well, yeah, so I'm Circe, and
I'm Tommen.
We've got Tommen.
Yeah.
Well, we got plenty to talk about with those two today. That's for sure.
Damn. And of course, we've got Jon Snow.
Oh yeah, today, well, we're gonna talk about what Jon Snow's name may be later on in the show. But yeah, it's got a lot to cover in this episode. Of course, you know, there's been two pretty epic episodes back to back.
Yeah.
The Battle of the Bastards, and of course the finale.
Winds of Winter.
Yes, Winds of Winter. Winter is here.
I told Gina it's fascinating that for basically this, now that Winds of Winter popped up, the finale, it being titled that due to the nature that the new book that's coming out is of the same name.
Yeah.
That's a very good point.
So
I think that, you know, we can probably give, this is a pretty, it's going to be a pretty epic episode. So I'd say you can probably give, you know, a couple minutes just to give your overall, you know, feelings about both the episodes. You know, and then we'll kind of go into more of what stood out for you, because it's kind of hard to avoid too many spoilers in these two episodes. I mean, I think you can kind of for Battle of the Bastards because of the, you know, the way the battle was there. There were some epic moments, but eventually when you'll start going into the spoilers territory in a little bit. But just your overall feelings about the episodes. We'll start with the first one, you know, Battle of the Bastards, and then work our way towards the finale. But, you know, considering how the season's been so far for Game of Thrones, where would you guys rate these two, like, you know, Battle of the Bastards?
Wow. These two episodes, that's tough. That's... Definitely, I'd have to say this is my favorite season so far.
Agreed. 100%.
And
it's a lot of payoff right now.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yes.
So, the last two episodes were just so... I would say Battle of the Bastards, definitely in the top five favorite of for my episodes of the entire series. And the finale, Winds of Winter, also had a lot of stuff going on. And, both episodes rank up there in the top 10, for sure, of the entire series.
I agree.
The more I think about it, the more I think Battle of the Bastards might very well be up there. It's like, oh, man, maybe one of my favorite. Mm-hmm. It's one of my favorites, maybe my favorite. It's really tough to say right now, but wow.
Yeah.
It's a lot of crazy stuff.
It was a phenomenal episode.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got to agree. I think the Battle of Bastards, for me, it had some really good episode moments, but also just like from a technical standpoint, was just really well done. You got like pretty much film quality on, you know, a TV stage, basically. It was pretty impressive work. Like that, there were shots I saw there that, you know, some of it was kind of like the Sparta thing in 300, but a lot of stuff, you know, I haven't actually seen, you know, even in the movie form before some of those scenes. So it was like, this is some groundbreaking stuff a little bit.
Yeah.
When I did some research on that as well, I created two top five lists and Gina, you did too, right?
Yeah, I've got two huge lists.
Oh,
with
gosh.
Me.
You guys came prepared.
Yeah.
And so with that being the case, I ended up breaking it down and each episode I went in chronological order of what happened. And so my two top five lists, I mean, for the most part, it covers what's craziest at the beginning goes down, but it goes in chronological order. And also, with that being the case, I did some research on Battle of the Bastards and how that was shot, what kind of work they put in behind it, and it was insane.
Yeah.
Including the fact that they were originally shooting for over 40 days worth of shooting out of the original script. It was cut down to, I believe it's 25 or 23.
Oh, man.
And then they ended up having, it was 25 days for the battle, and then... they morph from the original script. And we'll get into that later and when without spoiling anything. But there's one scene that I've been telling everybody I've never seen in a fight sequence. I feel like I've never seen that. And that what I'm talking about, they actually threw that in. That was not in the original script. They threw in. Yeah, they threw that in because of saving time on what they were planning on doing. And they threw that in and they saved like 3 days.
Wow. Worth.
And so it was pretty nuts, but I think it made it even better.
What amazes me about that episode is how much of it was CGI work and how awesome it turned out looking. Like, you know, they had a bunch of extras, for this shoot, but think of how many actual, like, people were part of that. There's no way they had that many extras. So
exactly.
The amount of CGI work that they did for it and the way it turned out was amazing.
Yeah.
There was some pretty impressive stuff there. I mean, just for the standpoint of, like, a TV show, I don't think anyone's, like, there's not really any other show right now that's putting it on that scale right now. I mean, there's, you know, just a couple period pieces, you know, like Black Sails and a few other ones. But Game of Thrones is pretty much on another level.
Well, and that's why I broke it down to two lists. And even it was tough to do that.
Yeah.
So... there was something that, you know, having as much to talk about in each episode, but I was able to be as concise as possible within my list. Mm-hmm. So, Dennis, what did you have to think about the episode?
Yeah.
So I would say that like Battle of the Bastards for me was great from like a technical standpoint. I love kind of the balance there. A few things irked me, you know, a little bit. A couple things that kind of brought down for me. We go into a little bit when we go into the spoiler side of things. Mm-hmm. More just character choices, but from entertainment standpoint, it was great. Like, it was everything you would want from that kind of episode. It lived up to, you know, some of the classic battles we've seen before. And looking back at a few of the other ones, I would say the finale, pretty much, I wasn't expecting any of that. finale pretty much took the cake for me because it was like, wow, you guys are just... And then after watching some of the developer and the filmmakers and everything else, and they're talking about how they didn't want to introduce new characters really into the show at this point. So we knew there were going to be some changes, but, you know, how many changes would affect the ones we already know? Well, and we kind of got a good taste of that in the finale there.
The cinematography on the last episode, too, because they didn't have, I won't say much, but an on-set location for that huge scene, and so that almost all of that too was done CGI.
I think that was that was a good synopsis about how we feel about the two episodes. So I know you guys have two pretty thorough lists of you know, great moments in the show.
I feel like at this
point, you know, if you guys have not watched Battle of Bastards and Game of Thrones season finale,
you should just leave. No, I'm just kidding.
You guys have been being warned that we're going to be talking about both episodes in detail, and there's a lot of good character development and also just huge changes to the show. It's pretty hard to avoid at this point. So prepare yourselves. Winter is here. I'm going to hop right in, starting with the Battle of the Bastards. I want you guys to go ahead and start your list. Let's see what you guys got.
Oh my gosh,
Gina, you go first.
Well.
I'm curious because this is the first time looking at the notes. My first two words on my list is holy crap.
And mine is just talking about Danny and the Dragons. I just jumped right into it.
Danny and the Dragons. Yeah, that's so good.
Danny and the Dragons. Some serious revenge time, man. Whew. Because it didn't really start off. I mean, it started off kind of slow, and then boom, the ending was huge. But I mean, when I do finally get to the battle, it's that battle, though.
We pretty much had the same stuff going on here.
Different order, but
and there were certain things that I can't necessarily say right away.
Yeah.
Okay.
So where do you want us to start?
You can start, Gina, okay. For the top.
All right. Well, number one was Danny and the Dragons, man. Jeez.
Well, also opening that way, because I was expecting the entire Battle of the Bastards to be more or less...
The battle, me too.
And I was not expecting they come out dragons blazing.
Yeah,
literally.
Seriously.
That was a good, like, you know, it was a good time to kind of wrap up that that part of the story there, because we've been waiting for Dany to make her way back to back to the right place, and she finally got there, and they were like, yep, let's just move on through it. We got two more seasons left. Let's just go ahead and wrap this up.
Yep.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, part of it for me, I want to say it's kind of like, I don't know what the slavers were thinking exactly. I know that Dany didn't have quite control over dragons, or at least, you know, it did seem like she kind of got control of them pretty quickly compared to the last few seasons.
Yeah.
But when her name is Mother of Dragons, you would think they would have some kind of failsafe for dealing with the dragons, considering that they showed up like, oh, yes, we're going to come take back the city. She's got dragons. I mean, you've seen them before.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think they just disappeared? Do you think they were just, like, not coming back? Or...
Right.
Yeah.
So that was kind of a big mishap on their part. I was like, you guys could have thought this one a little bit. You know, you've been slaving people for about, you know, 1,000 years. You would think that maybe...
How do you disregard a dragon?
You know, and then there's three dragons. It's like, it's not even like it's just one. You didn't think the plan for one of them, at least?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, I know a lot of people, so we've talked about in previous podcasts, have kind of been ignoring, maybe, I guess... avoiding the entire fact that, you know, dragons are out there, and this definitely was like a giant, all right, well, especially in the scene with the slavers at the very beginning, and how Grey Worm goes to town on them, and that was pretty epic.
Yeah, it was.
I love that.
Yeah.
And it also, at the same time, with him saying, you know, tell them what happened here.
Yeah.
And, I mean, that is...
creating a legend is pretty much what's happening. She's creating a legend of, you know, about Game of Thrones. That's like kind of understated. Is that, you know, the heroes and like the people of this time, you know, it's like you're watching the show, but there's different legends being created on the show.
Yeah,
right.
You know that people are gonna be talking about and reading about, you know, in the realm of the show. You know, in the next 20 years, basically, like there's, you know, everything going on with Khaleesi right now, and her story. Mm-hmm. You know, the Mother of Dragons would probably be some book, you know, that some kid is reading, you know, 20 years down the line. So it's pretty awesome to see kind of like these main heroes there. You got like, you know, the Hound and these like bigger than life characters are like, you know, showing what are bigger than life really on the screen, which is pretty cool.
Yeah. What'd you guys think of Yara and Dany's little...
Oh, yeah, that was really interesting.
That was, like, a weird...
Because for that, I was like, huh, you know, it'll be interesting because we haven't seen... You know, we've seen Dany be sexual in a couple of ways, especially with...
Dario?
Yeah, and that's interesting, especially what she ended up doing to him recently. Mm-hmm. And I love her chat with Tyrion. Mm-hmm. Of course, that comes up here in the finale of season 6, but we'll get there soon. Point being, though, is that exchange between Yara and her was just very, okay, well, I didn't necessarily expect that, but maybe when she ended up saying in the finale about, you know, marrying, you know, maybe that's something that could end up throwing a twist here. And, you know, maybe they'll end up kind of flipping it on its head because we always have the exchange and the marriage of... you know, what ends up being a king and a queen, what if there are two queens? And I was like, wow, fascinating. Could they do that? Yeah, they could.
Yeah,
and that's
totally
a really interesting direction to see if they were to end up taking that approach.
Yeah.
So
I'd say there were some really good moments. And just like having, like you know, Dany shake hands and like that whole scene there, like the history, like muggy moment there, like, oh, the game is starting, you know, like there's finally... This big moment here where, you know, she's making her way over there. Like, it's been a long time coming. So now we're kind of finally making our way towards the end game. So that's pretty fun to watch.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was a pretty fun moment to see, like, you know, Dany's got a lot of clout right now. And again, you know, my theory still stands as far as, like, her kind of being in a position where she's just kind of made her way through most of her opposition completely at this point. Like, I mean, like, it's been...
Right.
Every single challenge or, you know, conflict, she's been able to pretty much wipe out by just pure force for the most part. And now it seems like with Tyrion around, you know, he's trying to use other ways. But
he's trying to be the politician.
Yeah, exactly. But pretty much, like they were saying, Conqueror is kind of where Danny's been leaning towards. Like, I know Carolyn was talking about that in chat. We're gonna get there, Carolyn. Don't worry. All right. yeah. So what's next on the list for you guys?
Yeah, that honestly, and her taking down the slavers, I ranked that number two.
Yeah, I went in order, I think, of the, this is really not my top five, it was more of a, just remembering the episode, kind of chronological, and then episode, you know, what I could remember from
then
the episode.
Then I'll add to that list.
Yeah, so, however, this does make my top five just, I love Lady Mormont, just saying, she only showed up for like 10 seconds in this episode, but she's just like throwing some serious shade over at Ramsay Bolton's the parlay or whatever, and so... I love her, and she comes in. She's on my list, I think, on for the season finale too. Mm-hmm. But she's just a great character. Yeah.
They did a great job of that. I mean, it's been kind of perfect. Like a surprise hit with the show.
Yeah,
we kind of need moments like that too. Like considering, like, you know, Hodor gone, you know, stuff like that. You know, you need kind of like those cult heroes for the show.
Yeah. And like, I also like Sansa. What she said at the parlay about. Like, you know, after Ramsay's just spewing off obscenities and stuff, she's like, "You're gonna die tomorrow, Lord Bolton," and she just turns around and, you know, rides her horse off.
And truthfully, this episode was a true shining moment for Sansa. Whenever she ends up, that what you're talking about, and at the very end, whenever she ends up walking away, like, damn,
yeah,
like she's, which is, you know, she's growing up.
Yeah, she's not the little bird that she was in King's Landing. Yep.
So I mentioned this earlier because I know that you guys love the Sansa. For me, I had an issue with Sansa for two reasons. All right, issue one is I don't understand why she didn't tell Jon. It really irks me in this episode. I was like, you know, you could at least, you told him to wait for more soldiers to come. You didn't tell him why. He's like, why should I wait for more soldiers?
Sure.
You could at least lean towards the Vale, maybe it would arrive. I mean, it was kind of weird just because Jon was in the battle the entire time. So there's no guarantee that he would have survived at all before they got there. And she pretty much put her brother's, you know, life at risk just to kind of ride in like
that's
the savior.
True.
And I was like, I don't know how I feel about that. I feel like they should have let them know before the battle.
That's a good point.
That is a good point. I think she wanted some semblance of power still, I think. You know, I think she's tired of people helping her. I agree with you, Dennis, about she should have told John, but I think there's some leftover, like, stuff she's picked up from her mother, how her mother hated John. I think there's some leftover of that.
Well, and also that might go to show how her and her mother are very similar in that regard, because Kat would end up doing certain things. You're like, come on, Kat, like, what the heck?
Yeah.
Like, why did you not just, like, open up and try to help the situation as opposed to, like, kind of being coy about it, and then you just screw everybody over?
Pretty much,
That happened.
Yeah.
And I guess, like, in a realistic standpoint, I guess, you know, she is flawed in that way, because it does seem like she wants to have that, you know, some kind of control over... you know, her life at that point, but it did cost people lives, basically, because if they had known, you know, there would have been a lot different, you know, battle strategy there, especially if you see that, you know, we haven't talked about Rickon at all, you know, considering, like, what happened with him, you know, that might have been potentially avoided had they just waited a bit longer for that to even happen in the first place.
You know, regardless, I think that would have been the outcome of Rickon. Maybe not that exact outcome,
of
what happened to him. Man, why didn't he zigzag? You always zigzag.
Yeah, why not just run one flat route or something, like one hook route, okay? Like, play some football, Rickon.
Yes.
Well, that was the other thing with him running as well. I was like, the way they're setting it up.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I talked to a coworker and like, you got the feeling that Rickon was going to escape. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, no. No, I didn't.
I didn't think that was gonna happen.
When Sansa said to Jon in the war tent, that she was like, "Rickon, he's dead no matter what. No matter what we do, he's gone to us. Like, we can't save him." And that's just because she knows Bolton, she knows Ramsay,
And these are the two things that I was saying about Sansa, because before, remember when she first mentioned it to Jon in the first place, she mentioned you know, well, they've got Rickon hostage, et cetera, et cetera. We need to go back and fight for our home. And then it became that's more true. Like, well, Rickon's just, you know, he's done for. So let's just let's just wrap it up and move on to our house now. I was like,
I just want to go home.
Yeah.
You know, and I was like, okay, Sansa, you know, but she does kind of make up for it in the last episode. We'll talk about that too. But
sure.
For me, that kind of stood out. And this is my opinion, but I have heard some opinions while talking to people online about it. Some people were saying that they were hoping that Sansa would go more of the Stark route with the Ramsay death. And just
keep him alive. I don't want to necessarily spoil anything right away because I want to go in order, but
some people are saying that, you know, they want, you know, her to keep some of that, like, I guess, Stark armor and like honor, I guess, with it, and maybe have it on display with, like, you know, the usual beheading with the sword,
yeah,
and all of that, and say this is not what, you know, Starks do. But the Vulcans, but I understand it being Sansa, so she's got plenty of reasons to hate Ramsay, just like all of us do.
Yeah.
I think this is awesome. Well, I wouldn't say this is the beginning of the new Starks, but we do see, of course I won't get into it now, another Stark perform something mm-hmm. that I was not expecting at all. And I don't know if anybody else was expecting that. No. And that was in the finale, but with that being the case, it was perhaps the Starks will end up acting in a very different way in terms of, you know, where they try to set a new name for themselves because mm-hmm. they're like, all right, you've taken us for being these loyal,
honor-bound,
this family who's based in honor so much that we're not going to bend the rules. And if, you know, you end up doing something that's so disgusting as Ramsay throughout his entire life, then we're going to treat you in a different way. I mean, that's not going to require the same path of vengeance, and maybe they end up bending the rules here or there. And I think that it was illustrative in both episodes that mm-hmm. Starks might be taking that mm-hmm. direction. I think they are.
Yeah.
I think the North as a whole was just different than the North that Ned left.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
At the beginning of the show. And now there's just not really as much of that left. I mean, though we see some of that ties to honor in the finale episode, but
yep.
mm-hmm. Really the honor and, you know, doing the right thing for Ned got him killed. And much for the most part, it's not working out very much for anyone else in the show. So
No.
It just may not be that time anymore. Maybe with the winter coming or arriving, it's just not that kind of world that they were raised in for so long.
Yeah.
But even with the acts of honor we saw with the flashback with Ned, you know, some things aren't necessarily as honorable as they remembered in the first mm-hmm. place. So
yeah.
All right. So what's next on the list for you guys?
That battle,
though.
that was number one for me, just because of so many different reasons.
Oh my gosh.
I'll let you go, and I'll pick out where.
Well, yeah, it's definitely like. In terms of top five favorite moments from the thing, it's like number, you know, one or two for sure. I mean, Lady Mormont kind of takes the lead for me, but the best like medieval style battle I've ever seen, you know, going through and doing some research myself, it's like the directors and the writers just there's nothing on screen like what they produced. You know, they did research on Roman mm-hmm. battles and all sorts of battles. And this is kind of a unique battle in of itself because you don't get that chaos that you felt while Jon was on the ground. And, you know, it's kind of a battle of luck really for most people, even, you know.
Well, that's what the creators, the showrunners ended up saying mm-hmm. in the behind the scenes on HBO mm-hmm. after the episode Battle of the Bastards, mm-hmm. where they said, truthfully, whenever you're on that battlefield and you're looking down instead of the barrel of a gun, looking down on a horse and a Kingsguard and a sword, it boils down to luck. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have skill. You're able to avoid things to an extent. But when you've got arrows raining down over you and you get these horses that are coming at you, and then you end up having the same way that they set up the formation that completely blocks you, mm-hmm. what General Hannibal ended up doing, and which they described as being an actual tactic used in history. I think it's fascinating that they, like you were saying, mm-hmm. Jeanette, they used actual history and then also showing that it's luck.
Yeah.
And especially when you get to the scene of Jon.
I thought he was going to die twice.
Being trampled. Yeah. And the very beginning when he was off his horse, I'm like, I don't think so, but how are they going to pull this off?
Yeah.
And that part kind of bothered me because I feel like the horses and his cavalry got there before they actually would have.
I kind of agree with you.
Like that I was like, I'm not, that was probably my biggest critique because John was standing there. I'm like, all right, so John's not retreating. He's going to get a lot more loyalist because of that. And I was like, okay, well, is John going to end up like cutting a horse and diving and like moving out of the way? What's going to happen? And that part I was a little bothered by. And that scene, I was like, is he going to die here? He could end up dying. Mm-hmm. And then whenever they had the formation, the bodies piled up they surrounded them on all sides, just like General Hannibal did in one of his battles, an actual historical reference. And then John is like pushed down and he's being trampled on.
Death,
I was like, what if he, like,
I know.
A that was, yeah, that was here. A good moment there. I was like, you know, this would be the worst death ever. And I was like, you know what? It being Game of Thrones, it could be so... It would be, it could happen.
That's Kit Harington's like greatest fear, actually. His getting like trampled or suffocated like that and crushed to death. So
it would be terrible.
I've never seen anything like that. Like, and I've never seen any battle sequence or scene like what they shot. And the creators, I went back through, and that's what I was doing some research on because I'm like, I'm really curious to see. I've never seen anything like that. And they said, there's a reason why you haven't. They're just whether it be in TV or film. We've done no show or films done that. And that is the scene they actually used to cut down on time. And they originally were going to do something else, but they were running out of days to shoot and the actual daylight to use. And so they said, all right, how can we end up shooting this? Well, they ended up using John and, you know, the rushing of people over him to, you know, that way they could shoot in daylight and in dark. And they would end up being able to kind of fudge that a little more. And then the rebirthing process, as they called it, when he was pulling himself up through the crowd, that was something that is very fascinating. In season 3 of Game of Thrones, there is a part where Dany is standing among this crowd. There's a scene very similar to that. Mm-hmm. People are, you know, like praising her, and she's in the center. And they wanted to do another visual correlation to that. I'm like, oh, that's cool, because we're getting a lot of nods here from the creators. Linking John and Dany, and that's one of the ways that they ended up doing that in a very visual choreographed way. And so that entire thing, that was to me, I love the entire battle, but the trampled scene was like the craziest, because that actually made me feel
like I was claustrophobic.
I was feeling like I was being crushed watching.
The anxiety was pretty
high. And I rewatched it. My roommate had been gone, so he was rewatching it a couple Fridays ago or something. I don't even remember. Regardless. He's like freaking out on the couch, and I'm like playing it up because, of course, I've already watched it. And I'm like, he's like, no, John can't die again. Is he going to die again? Oh my gosh. And I'm just sitting over there, like, about to, you know, like, fake tears. And I'm like, oh my God, man, it's coming. He was pretty mad at me. He's like,
that was a great moment for them, because if there was any way to like make people believe you're actually going to kill off a character again, that was probably the best way to do it.
And honestly, I thought the odds are not in their favor. They're going to lose. Mm-hmm. I'm expecting that everybody dies, including Ser Davos. Uh-huh. And it was even setting up for that, which I loved earlier. One of the best gifts was, and you ended up sending this, was happy shitting.
Loved that scene.
In which Ser Davos is talking about walking around the battlefield the night before because he can't sleep. And he's going to shit out his guts, walk his farmhouse, so no one can hear him do that. And so I thought that was really, you know, there were so many great moments.
There
were
some really good
moments.
It was a great episode. It's going to go down for sure in the top 10, I think, as far as just like the scale of the episode and just how much was done in that one. And even though they had to kind of, you know, play around with the veil and everything else to make the episode work, you know, but it was awesome.
Which I'd like to point out, I was wrong last podcast about where Sansa's little secret note went.
Oh, yeah,
totally
true.
Went to Littlefinger. So I was wrong.
They did a good job of playing that up, though, with the previous episode, because they did have, you know, Brienne show up with the letter as well, and then another, you know, houses. And so they did a good job of, like, keeping it, you know, secret there.
Yeah.
So So what's up next for you guys? You know, so it was a pretty big one.
Yeah. I mean,
Sansa's sweet victory.
Oh yeah, her sweet victory. Oh yeah, at the very end of the episode. Well, first of all, Jon beating Ramsay bloody was awesome. And the only reason why I think he stopped from completely killing him is it wasn't his death to take, you know, it wasn't his kill.
Well, you looked up and saw Sansa. And so, he's like, I've heard everything. And she's pulling like what Maggie ended up doing to Glenn in The Walking Dead. She's like, I'm not going to say everything that happened. And of course, there's much more that happened with Sansa here. And then, you know, that's a very interesting point to make.
Well, because Snow doesn't have, like, Jon doesn't have the same, you know, history of Ramsay, so it's not really his fight, you know, at that point. It was because it was their home, but really, you know, Sansa
has been hurt the most.
Which I think kind of pushes it into the same with Arya as far as, like, getting vengeance goes, because how much of it is just for your home and how much of it is just to get Ramsay pretty much out of there, because it seems like Sansa was pretty personal with that.
Yeah,
which, it's also cool to see her development of her character at the very end, where she stays to watch the hounds, his loyal hounds, his loyal beasts. She went to leave and then she stopped and watched. And then she turns around and smirks as she walks off. Yeah. Like, for me, I was like, yes, that's awesome. Like,
Sansa, I'm so glad she's actually badass.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. I was tired of whiny Sansa, I just started book three again, and so it's like I'm rereading all the whiny Sansa crap, and I'm just like, oh, so glad her character's better, like in the show. It just,
she's definitely taken after her mom.
Oh, definitely. And,
yeah, for sure. But
at this time, it's interesting to see, you know, the comparisons of how she's like her mom and those moments where she's not necessarily like her mom, because we never saw moments where her mom would end up doing that.
Yeah.
And she was very loyal, very much so had that Starkisms, where she wanted to be honorable, especially when she had Jaime captive
at
the very beginning of the series.
Yeah.
But with this, I think that it's starting to show a change in the Starks. Especially with Sansa and another Stark who we'll mention here coming up soon. But, you know, too bad Rickon couldn't stick around a little while.
No kidding.
I mean, like, really, like, the Starks right now, I mean, there's not really that many parental figures left at all in their life anyway. No. So it's like they're pretty much, you know, flying blind. So they just adapt to the world they're living in. I mean, like, if Ned had been around, you know, things would be different here, but who knows how long that would be around, even if nothing would happen at King's Landing didn't happen.
True.
The way this is going.
I do believe that if Ned were if he was going to be around a little while longer, it wouldn't be much longer. Mm-hmm. And the reason being is that I think, especially at the very beginning, the interesting thing, when I started watching Game of Thrones, I noticed how and I'd be curious to go back and start rewatching Game of Thrones, but I noticed at that point how different Ned was against all other characters in the universe that was created. Even at that time, and comparing him now, there's like no signs of Ned anywhere.
No.
In any character.
It's like a fish out of water. Like, even when he arrives at King's Landing, it's just like he completely, you know, the entire family is just like, what is this? Yeah. You know, like,
right.
And it shows, like, they stick out like a sore thumb. Everyone's like, look at this fresh meat here.
Yeah.
You know, it's like high school all over again.
Yeah, no kidding.
So, and I know that's what you ended up saying. Your last one is Rickon.
Yeah.
About why you couldn't zig and zag.
My gosh. Zigzag, man. It's like 101. You don't run in a straight line.
Well, and two, it's interesting because Jon, that was pretty much Rickon's death was the only, and you know, Jon had heard other things of what Ramsay had done before.
Right.
Yeah.
But Sansa lived with him. I mean, she's married to the bastard. And so, literally. And so with that being the case, she ended up experiencing going through a lot more. And that's why Jon stopped. But, you know, that was such a great moment, though, whenever Sansa, she's standing there. And, you know, Ramsay's he's even trying to talk himself out of it and try to stay comforted by the fact, like, oh, no, these are loyal beasts. These are my dogs. Like, I've trained them, blah, blah, blah. And she's like, yeah, and you've also starved them for seven days.
Yeah, exactly.
And so that was great to see Sansa stepping up in that degree.
But I also think it was pretty funny that even, like, Ramsay really thought he was going to live there for a second. So what's the plan? You're going to torch me for a little while, or, you know,
yeah,
you're not feed me?
It was so demented to see how much he was enjoying getting his face beat in by John.
Right? Yeah. Well, and what do you think, as he was talking to Ramsay, when he was talking to Sansa, there was one line that he said, he's like, I'm a part of you now. Are we, like, taking that literally? Like, is she pregnant with his kid?
That's what I was wondering as well.
Or is it just the memory of him?
I think that it feels more like... you know, he brought her down to his level.
Yeah.
A bit.
Yeah.
And so she can't go back, you know, it's like she can't go back to the way she was before.
Yeah.
And it's pretty much what.
I hope to God she's not pregnant, but
I don't think she is.
I don't think they would.
I don't think they're going that route without keeping him alive. I think if that was the case, they would have kept him alive for it.
Yeah.
Because, you know, having the bastard have another crazy kid, and that would have been a different play.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
But yeah, I think that was an awesome episode.
Yep.
I did get a couple tweets about the 7 days line, which they kept bringing up to me because Sansa wasn't actually there.
Oh yeah, I was just about to say that though. Really, how did she know that he had?
So like she walked, she already left.
She turned around and you know rode her. I almost said ran off, but she rode her horse away. So I'm like, how did? I mean, unless she just heard about it in the war tent or something, you know, whatever. I don't know.
But yeah, it was a great episode. But there were actually a couple like movie moments just to kind of make it more dramatic. But in the same way, I think that it does a good job of kind of wrapping up that part of the storyline to lead up into the season finale episode.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry though, but a giant should have been able to just like start plucking those guys out from behind those shield. Like I would have just been like grab a shield and start like just. Smacking things.
Hey,
I don't know.
Hey, you know what? The spear is hurt, though. I mean, like, he could have stabbed, like, you know, on the Achilles or something, you know, it would have been a bit rough for him.
Well, and also, no telling how many times he was stabbed.
That's true.
Shot
beforehand.
That's
true.
And there's only so much that he could end up taking. And of course, that was kind of a bummer whenever you end up seeing Jon Snow walking up. And then he just looks at Jon and he's like, all right, man, you made it. I did my job. Now I'm just going to die.
With an arrow.
And of course, it's Ramsay. Of course,
it is.
Just to make you hate him a little bit more. Just it's like just one more time. Yeah. We call him our character for you.
So I'm curious to ask you guys this question as well. I read a lot of articles after this episode in which people were, you know, celebrating, and which, by the way, the last two episodes have gotten a 10 out of 10 on IMDb.
Oh, wow.
So these two are the highest rated episodes, but are you guys, or were you really bothered by the fact that Ramsay was a character and he was around as long as he was because of the fact that a lot of people are saying that was the worst part of Game of Thrones, the fact that Ramsay just liked kicking a dog because he liked it and he did a lot of those things. Were you guys bothered by the gratuitous violence and the nature of Ramsay? Do you think that hurt the show?
No, two reasons. I think it gave us a different flavor for the show. You know, we're not just seeing a bunch of people stabbing each other with swords or fighting, you know, whatever. Yeah. But two, from the book standpoint, he is it's the exact same in the book. Like, Ramsay is just as psychotic in the book. I don't think he's as – and I don't know, since the other two books haven't been written, he's not quite as prevalent. Mm. Again, I can't really – I'm rereading, so I can't remember what what's going on in 4 and 5. But – I don't think it hurt the show, honestly. I think it was something that the show needed for
I still believe that, like, with a show like this, you still need people to hate.
Yeah.
You know, and it kind of, because there's so much gray area. Like, there's so many characters that are in between. Yeah. They're not quite bad. They're not quite good. I mean, that's great drama. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, you still need someone to kind of put that energy into you that you can just despise. Yep. And with Joffrey gone, you know, Ramsay, he stepped to the plate and he was ready to take that nice little spot on the throne there.
Yeah.
Very easily, yeah.
So.
And we wouldn't get a battle like the one we had that would actually have that kind of emotion behind it had we not had Ramsay involved. Like, he had already hurt so many different characters and, you know, it's been a long time coming, but it was one that was earned through, you know, his heinous acts throughout the last few seasons. So it was a good payoff considering that without Ramsay around, I mean, who are you going to really lean into if any kind of, you know, hatred besides, like, against the Lannisters, which, you know, are already there?
I mean.
And you also end up having, like, the true nature of evil. I mean, Stephen King is always infamous for having, like, you know, this very cut and dry, like, good versus evil. Mm-hmm. And I feel like there's a lot of gray and there's not a lot of like cut and dry, like,
that's true.
You know, evil or not. Oh. And I feel like Ramsay was that very black mm-hmm. and white. You are a bad guy. Yeah. You're like an evil guy. And no matter what, I didn't think that it took away. I didn't think that it was, you know, there were a lot of things that were vile that he did mm-hmm. for sure. I think mm-hmm. everybody can agree on that.
Yeah. But,
you know, it was interesting, especially with a lot of people chiming in afterwards about, you know, Ramsay's gone. Thank goodness that was the last, you know, bad part of Game of Thrones. Mm-hmm. But I was curious to pick your guys' brain on that. The other fascinating thing. So I was kind of finishing up about the battle. This episode was directed by, let me find out his name, Miguel Sapochnik. He also directed
Hard Home.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, exactly. Yep. So nice. I think it goes to kind of show as well the, because, you know, both were shot in a different way, but both had that epic feeling of,
yep.
you know, like two of the biggest battles in the entire
series. Yeah, and it definitely did. It was mm-hmm. both yeah. a great episode. So I'd say overall, definitely plenty to talk about with that episode, even after the show
yep. Yep.
comes back next year. They'll probably still be talking yeah. about this battle because it's a lot to live up to with two yeah. seasons left. You know, how are they going to outdo it, you know?
Well, and also in the finale, that was like another, in the very beginning of the finale, how that started. And that was like another epic thing that we'll be talking about forever. And speaking of characters who are bad, we have Joffrey, who's a very cut and dry bad mm-hmm. guy. Ramsay, who's above and beyond. I think we're starting to see, we do have a monster, and I'm not talking in a literal sense of the mountain, right here.
Little Cersei.
Yeah.
So, Cersei. We got plenty to talk about with Cersei.
She's not crazed. She's just empty, and that's worse than crazy. Like she's just nothing. She has nothing.
But well, I will say,
so we'll give our disclaimer here because we're gonna start talking about the finale of yeah. Game of Thrones. So you guys, ooh. You know, who've been hanging out, it's time to break down the finale now. We're gonna go into
Hey, Foot Kid.
Hello,
Foot Kid. Welcome.
I'm looking over. Since.
Oh, and somebody said hi to me earlier.
Hey, Young, saying hi to Foot Kid.
So we're gonna definitely break down the finale now. So I know that Carolyn has some questions and everyone else has some things.
Carol.
So
yeah, man.
So we're gonna break down some everything. But yes, Cersei has made a major play, which is pretty hard to avoid here. So you guys have been warned. We're gonna start talking about season finale here. We got a solid 45 minutes to break down everything that's gone crazy over the past episode. Yeah. So.
We
can just get started, I guess. Okay.
Well, before, let me preface this.
King's Landing.
Yes, King's Landing.
Literally.
But real quick, even before that, the soundtrack to the season after watching the finale, I immediately got on Spotify and downloaded it.
Oh.
And it's now, and I've been listening to Light of the Seven, which was the theme song to Your Devious Acts, Cersei.
Yeah.
So anyways, check it out if you haven't, I mean.
Yeah, I saw a lot of people doing that, actually. Like, the awesome. Night of, yeah. people went online, and that was blowing up online. Mm-hmm. So,
anyways.
That was blowing up more than Kanye's new music video.
Famous.
Yeah.
Why do I know the name? Okay, so
because King's... you watched it, right?
No, I didn't.
You got a title subscription, right?
So, I have a bulleted list, and for King's Landing, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sub-bullets off of the main bullet. So... there's a lot going on in King's Landing, and I broke mine down on my list here. There's no top fives. There's not, it's just a kind of mostly chronological. It goes. It's kind of it's broken
sorry,
down.
Sorry, I saw Matt to go over there with that. I just had to look over.
Oh my gosh! So it's
Denny's response as well.
Mine's broken down by places and by people. So, anyways, King's Landing.
Yeah,
man, guys.
King's Landing. Well, things landed in King's Landing for sure.
Yeah. King's How are you doing, by the way?
Yeah, King's Landing is called King's Landing for a reason now.
Oh,
I'm pretty
that was smooth.
Yeah. You feeling rather flat these
days?
Yeah,
well, I'm just...
like a soda that was left out for a while with the bottle cap off?
I feel like the ground is... I've just hit the ground, literally.
Yeah. I gotta say, the memes after this were just,
oh, my gosh.
Like,
golden.
But
it's,
all right,
it's
so,
almost like okay. they knew that they were gonna just be meme fodder for the next, you know...
Seriously, but...
Man, those Lannister kids. But I gotta say, yeah. though, I, at the beginning, when we podcasted in the very beginning, I was like, I feel like his time's limited. Mm-hmm. I don't think he's going to go right away, but I think it'll be like at the end, towards the end
of
the season. And with that being the case, I was like, all right, but I was not expecting this.
No.
I was expecting like Mr., you know, not Gary Busey. I don't know why I thought of Gary Busey. Bernie coming in. And I thought Bernie would end up finishing him off. And
I just... And that, as soon as I saw that the camera didn't follow him around the room, I was like, oh, my gosh.
Well, especially
with
the window that was open.
Yeah, I was like, he's...
Major fortune. Well, from the very beginning, whenever I was dressing up like this, and it looked like Cersei was going to join True Detective Season 3, and then we see Tommen getting suited up, I'm like, all right, Cersei's not going to die, but she's up to her devious acts. It's magic was saying. Mm-hmm.
There were some good shots there because they made it. They played it like you.
Oh
you,
yeah.
You thought you know Cersei was preparing for some kind of huge drag out battle basically because I'm like okay zombie mountain's ready. She's put on this armored dress.
Yeah, armored dress thing.
I'm like okay, some things are gonna go down here. And she's not even there.
Well, and like it was so cool to see Marjorie's train of thought. She's like, the Queen Mother is not here, and she knows the consequences of why she's not here. Like, that line was just like, hello,
Septon.
Septon, get your, you're not all powerful. Get your shit together.
Well, and two, I was a little, not bothered by that, but whenever they were all not catching on, I didn't think that was necessarily bad thing, I guess. Mm-hmm. Well, I was a little confused because I'm like, huh, I would expect them to expect backlash from Cersei. So they would be sending in like a lot of high power to get her. And they didn't necessarily do that. Although he did ask, was it Lancel to go get her with three of his dudes. And then he ended up finding that and But,
I think that the reason why it was that way is because he felt that he had to leverage with her son. That it's like okay, I have the king here, so you're not gonna go that far, as long as I have the king here still. But of course, we saw he got grabbed, so then his only leverage was gone at that point. So, he got outplayed basically. It took the entire season, but he got outplayed at the end, and then he realized it right before things hit
the
fan.
Right before you could just see that look of, shot on his face. So I wrote on my list, Cersei's the Mad Queen and not Dany. You know how that rumor's been flowing around? Yeah. One of them's the Mad Queen, which we have queens everywhere now, it seems like.
Yeah. Which I got to say, that's really cool. Yeah. Now that, we've got Dany, we've got Greyjoy, we've got, I guess you could say kind of.
Yeah.
But, and then the true, she's like Robb Stark, the true King of the North.
Yeah.
The true Queen of Salt Islands. Yeah. But then now we've got, me sitting up there and my crown or your crown. I just took it from you.
I gotta take mine off now. I'm not supposed to be wearing my crown.
But that's a very interesting point.
But I mean, Mad Queen. But
I'll gladly wear that title.
Well, she frequently said she burned cities to the ground to protect her children. So are we really surprised that she
burned part of King's Landing?
Use that wildfire, she knew it was there because of Jaime, and so it just are we surprised? I'm not. I mean, I was surprised about it coming into play, like I wasn't expecting it, but I'm not surprised that she
I'm not surprised that she used the wildfire, considering that really, as good old Granny Tyrell I mentioned earlier,
Olenna,
you have no friends here at all. Like, no one likes you.
She
even your own son turned on you at this point. So, what's left in King's Landing for you with the royalty at all? I mean,
I think Lady Olenna planted an idea or reinforced an idea Cersei already had in her head when she said, you stupid, basically idiot. You have you have no friends. You have enemies, basically. What are you going to do? Kill everybody? Boom.
Yep.
Idea.
I think I will.
Yeah.
Which, that was really crazy how they just started the episode with that.
Oh, my gosh.
They'll
forget about the fact that the good old Grandmeister.
I was going to say, he's in there. Grandmeister Pycelle has been wiped out by the stabby.
Yeah, those little birds were super quick, man. Like
stabby.
Yeah.
They had some training there, like little ninjas.
Seriously. Oh, I do like, so High Garden's officially wiped out.
The last one, Jamie, which it's true.
High Garden's officially wiped out. It was crazy.
Except for Granny.
Yeah, except for
Jenny's saying.
She can't do much, so.
Well, she's Granny. She's going to do a lot.
Well, she can't leave, she can't have any kids. So High Garden is like, after her, it's gone.
Well, but we also left off with a pretty cool type cliffhanger. Yeah,
that's true. There's some factions joined together here as well.
Yeah,
it's getting pretty crazy because when you think about it, like the houses right now are dwindling down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the major houses
getting wiped out completely. I mean, the Lannister bloodline is completely almost gone now.
Yeah,
You've got it. Pretty much, is only being held together by Tyrion and Jaime and Cersei. You've been pretty much putting out, incest babies over the last decade.
I'm kidding.
Well, and that's another interesting point because we've got Highgarden that's basically gone. Now we've got the Lannisters after King Tommen just looked out at the devastation and he just had his crown done and just whoop, gone.
Swan dive.
Yeah, with that being the case, the Lannisters, the two remaining Lannisters, are who we've got. Literally, three, but technically, I don't consider Tyrion a Lannister.
Yeah.
At this point, Tyrion didn't. He's never even really considered himself full. Mm-hmm. To a point, he did just to get what he's wanted.
Yeah.
But to that point, I consider him a Targaryen, to be honest. At this point, truthfully, technically speaking, he's Tyrion or Lannister. But Jaime and Cersei, the only two, and I think we're going to see another major wipeout. It's fascinating because look at what happened to the Targaryens at the very beginning of Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
And that's more or less where we were in history in this universe at that time. And then we're now kind of doing a reversal and history repeats itself.
Yeah.
But now it's not just going to be one house. It's going to be multiple houses.
And a mad queen.
And her... Did you like your epic revenge on the Shame Nun?
I did, yeah.
Shame Nun, man.
I was able to lock her away.
That was worst revenge ever.
What exactly was the mountain doing? Like slowly, like pulling a Braveheart and tearing her arm out of socket or something.
I feel like he was gonna have a good old field day.
Whether that means some rapey action or not, I don't know. Like,
see, I got the sense that he was going to like Ramsay and just like start cutting her open.
I don't know, man.
Feel like there was gonna be kind of death anytime soon. There, it was clearly you're gonna be in there for a long time.
Yeah,
And I love Cersei as she wipes out Shame.
Shame. I know, that was so awesome.
The thing that got me about that scene was that it was the first time that you see Cersei just pretty much admit to being who she is.
Yeah.
Like, she just pretty much threw everything out there.
And that line where she's like, it even feels good to confess,
under
the circumstances. Yeah.
Like, I enjoy all of this.
Sometimes
pretending I don't.
And two, I loved that, we end up having Cersei basically admit and confess to all that stuff. And then at the very end of the episode, we see the creator start to give some major shade in a good way, start to put some light in an area of addressing one thing that has been on everybody's minds. But I'm not going to jump the gun yet.
Yeah.
I'm not going to jump out of the window.
Oh, my gosh. Don't pull a Tom. Don't pull a me.
I'll go down swinging with
I don't understand how after all this shit these people have lived through, they still underestimate Cersei. I mean, because Cersei, she's kind of been that person to kind of step on in different ways until she brought the High Sparrow around, and then she kind of forced their hand, and now it spiraled out of control, and then she couldn't, It's been up and down. I'd say it's been a fair balance, though.
Oh, Magic saying I was impressed with how Cersei handled the loss of Tommen. She took it in stride pretty well.
I think she's just over it. She knew it was going to happen. Yeah. She believed the prophecy. I think she's just done.
I think she, especially whenever the High Septon ended up taking Tom, and she's like, all right, it's going to go this way.
Yep.
She ended up basically admitting that Tom was gone.
Yeah.
For a while. She's come to terms with that.
Yeah.
And so, and also when she's looking at the body, she's like, show me.
Yeah.
Show me. Just let it be done. I want to see. And it's like, well, you can't really identify him. I don't care. Just show me. You know?
I mean, because really, at this point, I feel like she couldn't kill him. But she, yeah. So that's why she got him out of the room.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
You know, he's already lost. So really, at this point, she did what she could as a mother.
Sure.
Except for her, be there
to console him.
Well, yeah, you know, in her eyes. But, of course, she's clouded by vengeance at this point. So
yeah, that's true.
Really.
But.
People were saying that on Twitter as well. Like, you know, why was she there, you know, when everything went down? Why wasn't she, you know, there to console him for all that there? Because mm-hmm. we haven't Maybe seen her there it. For that. Like, when you think about it, like, what's happened over, like, the past few episodes.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
she's been locked up in that room. You know, the king's commanding her not to leave. And he comes by, you know, every once in a while, just basically saying, "Ah, Mom, I still love you, but stay in his room."
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like,
yeah, that's true.
I don't know about you guys, but did anybody wish we had kind of, you know, after on The Talking Dead, they would always do a in memory.
Oh,
or the
memoriam.
Yes. I was like, man, I kind of wanted that to happen.
Tom and he's like,
well, that and like the guy, all the people got killed by the bell. I was like, I just was like, as that was happening.
Oh, I had one like that. If I could find it, I'd show it on stream, but I don't know where it's...
Nice.
I love how the High Septon ended up feeling the burn, like, right up his ass mm-hmm. whenever that blew, and it was just...
It was awesome.
And it was crazy, like, the camera shot, it was looking up, you know, it had the superior shot going on, mm-hmm. and then it's just that green wildfire.
It was, like, the look on his face, like, he just knew that...
Yeah, he was done.
Yep.
He got beaten. It was just, it was so quality.
Yep.
I was like, you know, like, this look on your face right now is just so satisfying.
Yeah.
Because it wouldn't have been as good if he had just died and then, like, he hadn't had that realization first.
Right.
But having them, like, actually shoot that scene and, like, it was just a great moment to have it just, like, on the screen. That was so satisfying for me.
It was like,
you
know,
you've been smug this whole season. You've just been smirking away, mm-hmm. and now you just realize you know, the shit hit the fan.
Yeah, exactly. And which, side note, that actor who played the High Spirit or High Septon, he learned everybody's name on set. Over 500 people's names.
Oh, wow.
He learned every single person's name on set.
Man, talk about a great memory.
Yeah, yeah. They loved him on set.
Well, it's interesting. He was a great actor.
Oh, perfect
and,
for the
I mean,
the
everybody's
role.
Been fantastic in this. But, same way it's Ramsay seeing that defeat before he died. And he's like, oh, great. I'm going to get my face bitten off by my own hounds. And that was, you know, satisfying in of itself as well. So two extremely satisfying moments. And another great thing was, what you're saying there, number the very last bullet point in King's Landing.
Yeah, so real quickly, the whole Jaime Cersei, the exchange between them. Jaime looks pretty...
Vexed.
I like that word.
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, the prophecy has been pretty much coming true so far.
And that actually kind of wrote what I wrote down on some of my Season 7 stuff. Will Jaime end up killing Cersei as part of the prophecy, you know, states that she will... basically get killed she gets strangled to death basically. So is Jaime gonna be the one to kill Cersei?
I think so. I think that at this point it's gotta be most likely the way.
Yeah.
Like, but it's kind of like seeing how that would happen and why is gonna be the interesting part. My theory is that it's gonna involve Brienne at some point.
Yeah, I do too.
That would be awesome.
Well, I think that Brienne might end up taking out Jaime as well. And that I at that point I think that it'll be the end of Cersei and Jaime at the same time. That's my prediction. Are you thinking the same thing, Dennis?
I think that could be actually what happens, yeah. That could be. I'm leaning towards that idea too. It's looking like not looking good for the Lannisters at all right now. Like, the infighting and everything else there, just it's so rough. Yeah. But yeah, I'd say that was a great moment too, because they did kind of leave that moment in there with Jaime just to kind of keep your thoughts in there. You see the video?
I also see Magic said about Tommen.
Yeah, he was pretty weak.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So, to keep things rolling, I just have to, one thing about Old Town and, you know, the random moment we had with Sam and Gilly at Old Town. Did you guys notice the giant sphere thingy that, you know, the it's the same thing in the opening credits. It's the
sphere.
Yeah, the what they use
as
for,
it rotates, the rotating sun or whatever.
Yeah, in the opening credits is what is in the middle of the library at Old Town. And I guess it's probably some type of reflector thing for them to have light during the day, because you saw all those mirrors and stuff.
Yeah.
What it's going to do, I don't know if it's going to have any significance later. That'd be kind of cool, but...
I think they might end up using that as a sense of how that's basically in the sky, you know, and it's been treated kind of like sword slash, you know, sun. And with that being the case, or at least the sound effects during the credits, from that, I took that as Sam was overlooking the entire library and seeing all these books, and then you end up seeing the sphere. I think that's going to represent the fact that it's in the sky. All the information's out there to know about all the lands, all the houses, all this stuff. It's whether or not you have the time and the ability to go there and be that kind of person that's going to end up representing that to a degree.
Right.
And I think it might be more of a symbol, but... Mm-hmm. By the way, I also love how Sam's just like, all right, see you,
see
Gilly.
I gotta go. Don't you understand? And then I liked seeing the white ravens taking off. That was really cool.
Yeah, that was pretty cool too. Yeah.
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 That was an interesting moment just because, like, Sam and Gilly, I feel like there's been like a comic relief kind of thing going on. But they did kind of open up the world a bit more there with actually seeing a bit more of what's actually going on behind.
And the Citadel.
Yeah, it's been nice to kind of see the world open up a bit more, just expanding in different ways without necessarily having to put, you know, all the major characters in there.
Yeah.
You know, it's nice to kind of throw in a scene like that for a couple minutes just to kind of change it up compared to what had just happened beforehand, so.
Every time I heard the Citadel, by the way, in this season, I kept thinking of Mad Max Fury Road, where we've got Imperial Joe, where he's like, the Citadel. I just kept thinking of that.
I would love to have a movie night with that, with Mad Max one night. That'd be awesome.
Yep, that's what's going to happen in Dorne.
Yeah. Oh.
Going to have Furioso rise up.
Dorne is a few bullets down, but let's just talk about Dorne.
They show it up again after like six episodes, you know.
I was gonna say, it's finally back.
I was gonna say they got a return to it, and they finally did.
Yeah, I'd say Dorne was kind of like what's the point of them right now this season, and then we finally got a point for them, you know.
Yeah, and then now we know what Varys' secret mission was, which
and that was cool to see the reveal. Like,
what are you doing here?
I was expecting him to go to King's Landing.
A lot of people were like really upset about timelines. So like, how did he get from the timelines? One of the writers,
it's very close, right?
Well, they said the timeline, they didn't want to spend 4 days, you know, showing Varys going back over to Meereen on a boat. Like the timelines don't match up, and they're, you know, and that's okay. Like I'm okay with that. Like,
Well, people are going to nitpick about those kind of things because they nitpick about everything, you know, and
would you rather see the outcome right away or spend 4 episodes of somebody on a boat, you know? Yeah.
At the Citadel.
Oh, Bobby, his secret mission took him to downstream.
Yeah, that's true, Bobby.
That's so true.
The Bobby 90.
Downstream, the Bay of Dragons.
And downstream meaning that they actually went to the Citadel.
So there was definitely some good moments there. Yeah. Just as it's nice to see Varys still kind of have like a...
Tommy,
he definitely
has
some
good
moments.
I'm falling apart here, guys. Pancaking hard.
Well, yeah, you know, as long as you don't fall too hard, all right?
Yeah, just don't go over the edge.
All right, what else do we want to talk
Winterfell?
About? Winterfell. Winter is here.
Yep.
As Ned Stark promised.
Yep.
Which that was such a great exchange.
Which, yeah, I love how basically, Tommy, you're not doing
too good. It's okay. We're just going to go all the way up here now.
I love how John like made it like a half joke, half truth to Sansa, and he's like, "Winter's here." Oh, we're screwed.
Yeah.
But that's kind of how it went, and then they referenced that at the very end. You know, when they're all shouting, "King of the North."
Oh, the Red Woman got the boot, as you said earlier, Dennis.
Yeah. Which, are you guys bummed about it?
No.
I mean, I'm sure that people are like, you know, he should be more grateful because she saved his life. But she also, you know, got a kid burned at the stake. So I really don't feel
Oh my gosh.
Well, the other thing is with I think she'll be back. Yeah, obviously, she's going to come back in a very major way, considering that Nikita might be the Red Woman for now.
I think that she's served a purpose, you know, for the show right now. And
yep.
I do think it was a little bit kind of strange that, like, they kind of led her pretty heavily in the first couple episodes of the season.
I know.
Kind of just drifted off completely. She wasn't really there for the battle at all.
Nope.
Or any of that there. So it was kind of like they just kind of started her character up and then just kind of coasted through towards the end of the season. I thought it could have happened. That exchange could have happened, like, before the battle, if it was need to happen at the end.
Which, by the way, go ahead and correct me here, guys, but I was probably the most annoyed in this episode. I'm going back and replaying everything, but probably the most annoyed at how Sir Davos handled the situation. The fact of him being mad, I'm not saying that was a problem, but how he got mad then. Like, why didn't he get mad earlier? Was it the fact that he found right before the battle the small toy, and that reminded him of how painful it was, and that anger led him through battle, and by the end of battle he was still so angry with it all that he's like, because of you, Red Woman, we're here, and da-da-da-da. Like, what do you guys think about that? Because I was like, well, why is he now, like, jumping the gun on this? Or was he just distracted by the fact that he wanted her to bring Jon Snow back so badly that he was willing to overlook all of this, and he was, you know, willing to, because it was Brienne during that timeline, and why didn't he lose it then?
So he always, you know, he never really liked the Red Woman.
Sure.
And then I think when he found Shireen's little horse figure before the battle, he knew he had to take care of business first and go through the battle. Like, he couldn't abandon Jon because he wanted revenge on the Red Woman. So I think he just had to get through the battle first and just see if you, but you're right. Like, why didn't he take, cause he could have died. So why wouldn't he have just, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't remember where Davos was towards the end of that exchange, you know, before the battle took place with the Woman and the rest of the group there. Like, was he actually, he wasn't there, right? Like, at the fight before, like, last season?
Yeah, like, he was sent away to go back to Winterfell.
That's right.
Or, I'm sorry, the wall.
The wall.
So, like, did he actually know that it had happened? I don't think he knew.
So when he found the horse, that's when he figured it out, that she had burned Shireen.
He had
no idea.
Okay.
Until that point.
Then that makes it easier, because for some reason I was thinking that he knew before, and then he was starting to freak out then, just because it was like a reminder of, like, oh, you know, she's a bad person.
Well, I think it was the revelation that what happened with, because the horse was, he knew that was hers.
Yeah.
And it was burnt or charred.
He had no idea that Shireen was dead.
Okay.
I guess, like, that could have happened at some other point, but I guess they needed it to happen near because of it being outside of Winterfell.
Sure.
They had to do it at that point in the story, but the timing was kind of, like, you know, a little bit weird comparing, like, it kind of, like, the battle itself reached a high note, and then you had the finale and everything else, and then it, like, hit that note with the Red Woman, and you're like, you're still here. Davos is like, why are you still here? It just felt like that was a little bit awkwardly paced. But you can understand a few moments like that.
Oh.
All right, Caroline, okay. Guys, what if sacrificing the little girl was actually the magic that ended up saving Jon? That'd be interesting.
I mean, you never know.
Well, yeah, because you never... Yeah, exactly. That's something that could be connected in some way, and that might have, you know, been like a sacrifice, if you will, of, you know, like... that's a really interesting point. I never thought of it that way before this.
Yeah, I mean, considering what we haven't talked about yet about Jon, you know, and how she's been, you know, saying that he might be the true one, and she was wrong about everything else before.
Yep.
I mean, I could see there being something else there.
Yeah. So, speaking of Jon, R plus L equals J has been half confirmed. Yeah. We can all assume, but you know what? I'm not assuming anything until they actually confirm it.
Because right now, because that's his castle, right? That's R's castle.
R is Rhaegar.
Rhaegar.
So I've always been. Oh no.
Yes, Carolyn, you did a good job with the question there.
So, I think, me personally, my opinion is Rhaegar is his father. But I'm not going to assume anything because it's Thrones and you never stinking know what they're going to do. I'm still waiting for Stannis to show up, honestly.
Pop, pop.
Seriously, without us seeing his death, I really don't know what the heck's going to happen with Stannis. Does he come back as a White Walker? What are we going to know?
Well, just like Benjen.
Yeah.
It could be like that, you know.
Uncle Benjen, yeah.
John is a king.
John is king in the north, which that scene was very reminiscent of the scene where with Rob being king of the north.
Yeah.
Yes, but in different circumstances. Yeah.
Again, Lady Mormont. She's just shaming all those old men. She's like, come on, guys. Man, she's just great. Oh, so great.
It was I wonder like what her audition was like.
I would love to see her audition tape.
She's like the Reddit of Game of Thrones.
Yeah. She's just great.
There was also, you know, and this is where, for me, you know, after having Sansa kind of be a little bit iffy for me in the last episode, her in this episode I was actually pretty impressed with because she did... let John have that moment there. She could have still put in her bid for the throne at that point if she wanted to.
Yeah.
Given her lineage. So it was kind of cool to see her sit back. She's finally trusting John enough to kind of go, okay, I'm going to let you have this.
Mm-hmm. Did you see that look she gave Littlefinger right at the very end? I think she's a... I think she's just...
It's a director here.
Oh, man.
You just watched it.
Oh, man. I think she's...
Interesting.
Yeah, I don't think she's upset with John or upset with him more so, and I don't think she really wants the acknowledgement. But I think at the same time, she's just like, "Look, you're king of the North because of me. So you know, it'd be nice for you to." John's just so naive. He doesn't, you know, he's not paying attention to Sansa.
Yeah,
I think that's gonna be bad.
I feel like John is happy to be alive, and he also was happy that you know. I don't think that he's just thinking of a bigger picture. Like Sansa's still, she hasn't seen the White Walkers, so she's still worried about these, you know, her house and, you know, Littlefinger, and it's just she wants that kind of control back to have some kind of stability in her life again. Mm-hmm. John thinking about what he saw out there on the wall, and he doesn't want any part of that. So he's thinking something bigger than she is, and she's still trying to, you know, play the game a bit. And of course, Littlefinger is trying to play the game against everyone. We saw that as well. He finally confesses what his true purposes are. It only took like six seasons.
And she totally shuts him down. That's a pretty picture.
Sansa, yeah.
Boom,
that's a
gone.
Pretty picture and walks off. Poor Littlefinger.
Yeah.
I don't feel bad for Littlefinger.
I don't either.
No, I don't either.
He's playing the game, and it makes you wonder, like, how much of it is just an obsession with, you know, Sansa,
with her mom,
and how much of it is actually just because right now that's the key to the North, and they can make his play there by marrying her.
When Bronn finally gets back to the North, really, he's got the biggest claim now since he's the last or the next male heir.
Yeah,
and I think that sets up perfectly for, you know, good old Jon as well.
So will Bronn finally get, you know, he's going to the wall obviously, but will he get home to tell John what he saw when he
and that's interesting because with everybody saying that, you know, you have Ned Stark's blood running through you to John, and what will they do when they find out that's not true? Well, I think that his, you know, little brother or half brother is going to be like, yeah, that's not true, so just keep it on the DL and don't, like, I'm going to take over, but like, just
well, it
so
depends
you know.
On yeah, it depends on which part of Revelation comes first. Because really, you know, I was talking to my friends about this after watching an episode. Who has the best play of the throne right now? I mean, the entire Seven Kingdoms. You know, people are saying Danny, but then you have John.
John.
Really, between the two of them, like, John has the bigger play. And of course, you know, Danny, which you saw as well in the, you know, episode where she decided to, you know, leave her lover behind. She's making a play. I mean, you know, being a single lady with that kind of power, who's going to look the most enticing to her probably when she gets to King's Landing? I feel like, you know, finding her way to Jon most likely would be the option.
Which would be
kind of interesting considering that they might actually be siblings or at least some kind of remnants, you know.
They could be cousins, actually.
Could it be like an FDR situation in which they end up, you know, king and queen? And of course, very different circumstances, but where they are together, but they don't.
Right.
They're not, you know, they just do that as like being a, an ultimate power couple.
Well, the Targaryens. Being
brother and sister.
Targaryens.
It would be, if it holds true, John would be her nephew.
Nephew.
That's messed up.
Yeah. But the Targaryens, the Targaryens married within each other. So it doesn't, it's not uncommon for the Targaryens they wanted their bloodline to stay their bloodline. So they frequently married their cousins and their nephews and blah.
I wonder how much John would be down for that, though.
No, I don't know.
I don't know, like, how much he would be down for that kind of action.
Once Danny walks through the door and jumps off her drying, he's like, all right, I'm cool.
Yeah. Which...
That's the flashbacks, I mean, I wonder if Bran's going to get there in time to actually tell him exactly what's going on.
Mm. I don't know, that's what I'm thinking.
Because... it's going to make things interesting just from the throne standpoint, because it makes both of them a target for different reasons. And we still don't even know how, you know, even though Dany's willing to play around a bit with, you know, her single status just to get, you know, foothold, you know, west there. I don't know if she's, like, ready to kind of, like, give up.
Her independence.
I like the moment with her and Tyrion just because... it was a good moment to kind of show her vulnerable after seeing her pretty much just, you know, strong, and she's just riding in on a giant dragon. But she was really vulnerable there the entire scene. Mm-hmm. Like, she's actually scared. He's like, you should be scared.
When you play the Game of Thrones, you either live or die.
Well, it's also a really interesting thing, because with her bringing that up, it's also relative to what Robb Stark ended up going through, in which Robb ended up going for love. And if Dany ended up pulling a Robb, she could have fallen into that same trap, and therefore it would have held her back, and things would have not worked out in her favor. Da da da. You could even end up saying that that is another way that it could have happened if she were to stay in to that degree. But you know, with that being the case, like what you guys are saying, it depends on how far Dany's wanting to go. Right. She willing to really say, "Hey guys, I'm off the market," or is she going to end up staying single and just be? I think. That it'll come down what she'll end up having, like, you know, she'll be queen and she'll find her king, or maybe, I don't know, it's possible that she might end up settling down with Greyjoy.
Oh,
you see what you think about, you know what I think, my theory right now, all right, is that, yes, Jon and Dany are the best ties to the throne.
Yep.
But I feel like this is the perfect opportunity for Littlefinger to involve... I feel like he's going to end up setting up some kind of kind of betrayal for John and make it look like that he may have been making some kind of play on Dany dying, which of course he won't be, but Littlefinger will use that to the perfect advantage, I think.
Of course.
To swing in and just go, well, I'm here to save you guys from...
I'm declaring for House Targaryen now.
Sorry. That's true.
Sorry. Because with Ramsay gone and pretty much just Cersei here, I think Littlefinger's kind of like the last big bad left, kind of, I guess you could say, at this point. Yeah, Carolyn, Carolyn, yes. You have a good point. The three Targaryens rolled the dragons together. Yeah. They're better off working together. Like, who's the third one?
That's been questionable. You know, some people, obviously, the first two we've heard, or we all think it is Jon and Dany. Some people think Tyrion's the third dragon, so... I don't know, as coming from book reader, I have no clue. I can't even give you, maybe once I get through the books again, I'll have an idea for when we do these podcasts again, but I have no idea.
Gotta say that I gotta give, like, them credit for, like, Tyrion's arc overall. Because it's come a long way, considering, like, where he was in King's Landing, when he was, you know, pretty much strangling the woman he loved, and killing his own father.
Oh my gosh.
To where he is right now in this season is pretty, a pretty deep change there. It's pretty crazy.
I'm really terrible at consoling. Yes, you are. So Tyrion's Hand of the Queen now. Yay. He gave. He was just so, like, that's his place. He's just so happy to be Hand of the Queen. And
it was a great moment. I'm glad they've been giving him a lot to work with as far as, like, scenes and, like, you know, good writing. Mm-hmm. You know, just, like, good moments there with him and Dany just for, like, she actually appreciates him. Mm-hmm. And he finally feels like, you know, someone's seeing him as, like, you know, an equal.
A person.
Yeah, you know?
Yeah.
Like, they actually value his opinion beyond just, you know, for fun.
I think she's on her way to Dorne. What do you guys think?
Oh, first. You think that she's, well, with we Varys, have Varys who's right beside her. So there's a good possibility. And they'll team up with, you know, Grandma Tyrell. So yeah, that's a good point.
I think that's, I don't know though. I don't know. We'll see.
I think that the way it's set up right now, that she did make the pact with the Greyjoys to take back their homeland. So I think that their plan, which is probably where they're going to meet Jon, will be to go through the North first, gather up there, and then make their way up to King's Landing.
Mm-hmm.
But that gives them a little bit of some kind of leeway there, because I don't think they're going to go straight into King's Landing.
Yeah, no.
From the get-go.
Well, and the Carolyn said a good point. Dude, Cersei still thinks he killed her son, talking about Tyrion, and he's Hand of the Queen. So you don't really want to go to King's Landing first, you know. Because
and that's it as well. Like, when they were riding on the boat and they have that epic shot and the dragons flying by, my one thought is like, oh, yeah, Danny, that's awesome. But the second thing that was very close is like, what's going to happen whenever Tyrion comes face to face with Cersei? And I think it's going to happen. I really
do. It's going to come to blows.
And will that be the end of Tyrion? I don't think so, but it could be. You know, it's Game of Thrones. And at the same time, though, Cersei's going to, like Carolyn said, it's Cersei's, and she will always be convinced until the day that she dies that Tyrion killed Joffrey. And she will always link that. And happens, though, whenever she sees Tyrion and Sansa together? Bringing a good point. If they go up north and then work their way down.
Oh, my gosh, because she thinks Sansa's part of Joffrey's death, too.
And Cersei in the state she's in right now was pretty scary.
They got the mountain.
Vexing.
You know what? Like, I think that my theory, considering that, would be that if there was a play made for the throne, and so Dany and Tyrion get involved, and Cersei ends up not wanting to play that game and ends up killing one of them, I feel like that would be when Jaime would step in. If they were going for peace without battle, and Dany was like, I'm going to offer you guys a chance here to just submit, and she chooses not to and kills Tyrion, I feel like Jaime would kill her.
I think so, because Jaime does really love his brother,
That's a really good point. I think that could end up happening.
Yeah, I think so.
So, like, what do we have left there? We even talked about Arya.
That's it.
Arya and Walder Frey. He's been so
that was a great character. Sweeney Todd moment.
Oh my gosh! Oh, so glad that happened.
So did you guys see that happening at all?
No, I had no inkling of that at all.
I honestly was like, all right, the last time that we were here with the Freys and we were sitting in this room, we know what happened. Red Wedding. I was like, what if the Freys are like, hey, by the way, we know, you know, we're going to make a pact with you Lannisters, but we know that you guys are dying. By the way, you guys are dead.
Yeah.
And I thought that Frey was going to end up killing Jaime. Mm-hmm. He was going to stage it. And whenever Bronn was there and he left, I'm like, oh, man, this is not looking so good. What if Bronn leaves and he's the one who escapes, but the rest of the soldiers and Jaime, for the most part, are there and they end up killing him.
Mm-hmm.
But with the major twist coming in that Arya is now here, and she takes off her little, you know, assassin mask. That's very interesting, especially to see that crazy arc of another character who comes from this person from the very beginning who's wanting to get revenge, and then she does, not just on Walder Frey, but his sons, and chops them up and feeds them to him as well.
Yeah.
She's a dangerous character now because she has the art of many faces now, which I'm pretty sure she's had the kill for the faces in the first place.
I'm really concerned, like, how much over the edge is Arya going to go? You know, like, I'm a little concerned about
until
her
that list, the names in her list are marked off. I'm pretty sure she's going to stay at that point.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. But, you know, ironically, it's just funny that she had no idea that Walder Frey and the Freys killed her mother, you know, slit her throat. So it's ironic that that's how she killed Walder Frey. Because how would she have known? She would have known. And then Walder Frey, you know, out of all the people, out of all the houses that wanted him dead, Stark gets him, and he I think that was the last family he thought would ever come for him, honestly.
And that was another great revenge type story. And but at the same time, it draws deep concern for the psychosis of
Arya. And I gotta give the show credit for that as well, because they do a good job of making you care about the mental state of some of these characters, because you've watched them grow for so long. You're like, how much of this is, like, you know, left? how much of the character we saw at the beginning of the show is left here? Mm-hmm. You know, are you completely changed now? Or are you going to be just a killer and that's pretty much all you are now? Because really, I mean, Arya, she's had no... The only little moment we've seen of her, you know, showing some of the aspect of herself beforehand has been in the theater there.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. With the actors. And we saw what happened there. They pretty much snuffed that out pretty quickly. He's like, oh, you're not going to have, you know, a friendship or, you know, dreams outside of, you know, revenge? Well, that's not going to happen here.
Right.
We'll just, you know, smash in a chair. That's and that's a brutal reality, but now I don't know if Arya has room for that kind of life anymore.
Yep.
Yeah.
Kind of scary.
Guys, we did it.
Yay!
Guys, we did it. We got through most of the major points.
And these were like some beefy episodes in the sense of everything that ended up happening and how many people ended up dying at my hand.
Yeah, she just boom, wipe out.
Yeah.
That scale, like the death total there, I was like just sitting there like, oh my god.
Yeah.
I can't believe they were just killing off everyone.
Seriously.
Just so, like, Marjorie's face for me was like, that moment there where she's like, we're just all dead. It's over.
Yep. Yep.
Like, I think the audience had the same exact face that she did there.
Dang it.
Like, I feel bad for Marjorie, I think, probably the most right now, because she played the game well.
She did.
I feel like in a way, she pretty much, it was been her and Cersei this entire time, kind of like, you know, taking swings.
Yep. Yeah, no, you're right. I agree with you.
And it's like, the highest sparrow ends up being the one that ends up killing it for her. It's like, it wasn't even in your hands at the end of the day. You didn't even have any control over it.
Mm-hmm. No.
Well, she did save her grandmother. So
she did.
That.
She did get that. Yeah.
But then again, there's like nothing left of her family.
Yeah.
I guess her grandmother's the only one who has the rightful heir to the house name, and that she would be able to join forces with Dorne. And with that being the case, Dorne is with Dany right now. Would you say that?
Yeah.
Because
I would say so.
Dorne, Tyrell, Dany.
Well, and the other reason why I say that is in the book, they've eliminated a storyline that was in the book where Dorne was going to side with Dany.
Oh.
Yeah.
When Prince Dorne was still alive, he sent one of his sons to go find Dany in Meereen. So I think that this might be their way to make up for that storyline they cut out.
Yeah. I gotcha.
Maybe.
Okay, well, that makes sense.
So I think Dorne's going to go with Dany.
And you guys think that Dany is going to the north first, and then she's going down south?
I don't know.
To King's Landing?
I need to look at the map.
Dorne, it depends on what they want. Like, at this point, I feel like the Tyrells, you know, I think she's just helping on revenge. So they'll take whatever they can get. And Dorne, you know, they never liked the Winterfells anyway.
Yeah.
None of them. So I feel like if there is a bigger power play for them, and keep in mind that the islands they just left, you know, and Khaleesi and everyone else that just left there, there's still going to have some kind of power control there as well, because she's not coming back, most likely. So they could probably talk to Dorne about that, you know, sending someone out there to kind of take that over at this point. So there's probably some big political swings going on there. Yeah, so we did do it. We got, like, you know, another, like, 6 minutes. You guys can go crazy. I know Carolyn's talking in here.
Yeah, looking over at Carolyn over there.
Oh.
With some, she's got some good stuff.
Yeah.
Carolyn's been chiming in with some great comments here.
Yeah,
some
thank
great
you.
Theories. So what do you guys expect? Big theories coming up. I saw that you, Ginny, you've got Where's Brienne and Pod.
Where's Brienne and Pod? Will we ever see Gentry again?
What's going to happen with Sam, Gilly, and Little Sam?
Yeah.
I say, like, their path is going to probably be out there like Bran. You know, they're going to have some side moments, and then I think Bran's going to make his way back to the rest of the group, and there's going to be some revelations there, because he has that kind of power. There's going to probably be some more flashbacks later on. I win. Yes, Carolyn. Yes, you know, and yes, she did. Like, she did poison. You know, we forget about who actually poisoned Joffrey. But yes, that's the thing.
Carolyn, I think the crown goes to you.
Oh, there you go.
There it is.
We were just talking about you being a princess earlier, Carolyn. So there you go.
There you go. Do you think the Hound and Arya are gonna meet up, since they're kind of in the same neighborhood right now?
I predict that.
I think so too.
I see that happening.
I'm seeing, like, that Arya, the way she is now.
sorry, I just read their comment about Pond. Oh, yes, it's perfect.
Yeah. I'm leaning more towards Arya actually joining the group that the Hound is with at some point.
The Brotherhood or whatever. The Brotherhood, the men, something without banners, I don't remember.
Yeah, I can see that too. I think that might be the task for her. Killing righteously, I think, would be kind of like the right moment for her after she finished her little revenge thing.
Yep.
But, I mean, I wonder if the Hound would still be on her list or not at that point.
I think she'll be able to, like, forgive him.
Yeah. Well, I think he's off her list because she thinks he's dead because she thought Brienne killed him. Remember, she left him lying there, dying?
Mm. Yeah, but she finds him again, though. Would that be gone, or was she...
I think the debt's been paid.
I think it's been paid, too. I just wonder if she still has that conflict, or if she's, you know...
Sure.
It'd be an interesting piece of drama, you know, just to see.
Yeah, I think she's moved on. I'm done. I think that she's moved on from the Hound, but the Mountain...
Oh, yeah.
What if Arya takes on the Mountain?
That would be
awesome. That would be an amazing fight.
Yeah. That would be so cool.
That'd be the biggest, you know, David and Goliath fight we've seen ever on the show, I think.
They might stage that. That would be really especially cool. Especially considering how Game of Thrones, I love how they end up bookending and doing a lot of the, you know, history repeats itself. And from the very beginning, whenever we end up seeing her master, who's there training with her on sword fighting, then she sees him die in front of her. Maybe that will be something that happens, and she ends up, you know, taking on the Mountain.
The parallels are there. It's a good point.
So
I gotta say, you guys got some great commentary. It's been an awesome season with you guys as well.
Yeah, it's been fantastic.
I want to thank you guys. You've been hanging out with me since the beginning of the season. We would cover all these episodes.
It's been fun.
A lot of commentary. I think the show's been getting better and better every episode. Yeah. We managed to cram in two, like, you know, massive episodes in like an hour and a half, which is pretty impressive work. I think this is pretty solid for the show. So I'm looking forward to some new stuff with you guys as well. So
grab the shield. Let's grab the shield. Gina. We've got
gotta get some plugs in there.
We do. And so of course we've got there at Sir Daniel Posey and then at the Beans 89 for us. And of course, everybody who has been watching the podcast probably been checking us out on Twitter as well there, because we chime in about Game of Thrones with Denny there, and we've been chatting quite a bit about a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
And if you also see right before the podcast, I ended up just making the music video go live in which I'm producing for the band who played in our little short film, Little Rip in Time, Sabrina and the Howlers. So go check out the teaser right now. That's up on the Twitter handle right now. So
follow us if you haven't.
Yeah, and then that way you can talk about Game of Thrones outside of the season. Yeah, with us.
This is the sad part. We have to wait.
To go.
I know.
we have to wait for winter to actually come here.
Yeah.
So now that winter's finally here, we're just waiting for Game of Thrones. Game of Thrones is coming.
Yep.
Yes, it's been a great season. Yeah. I want to thank you two, you know, Daniel and Gina for being here. You know, and being part of the show has been an amazing season.
Well, Denny, thank you for having us. Thank you. It's been a blast.
It's been really great.
I look forward to especially dressing up in character.
We're gonna probably step up our game hopefully next season.
Oh yeah, we got like what, 7 episodes in that season.
Yeah, so
that's right.
It'll be pretty crazy. So I'm looking forward to it. We got a couple months to, you know, break things down, get to, you know, some good wigs going on there.
Exactly.
Yep. So
Daniel and Gino rock. I have to agree. They do definitely rock. It's been a great season. I'm looking forward to more content.
Thank you, Marilyn.
And
the podcast will continue. I'll probably find another episode or something to have you guys on for some.
Cool. Please.
Pretty long season coming up, you know, of summertime movies, and you know, I got a couple other movies coming out, you know, Suicide Squad cover things.
That's right.
Yeah.
That'll be great. And
you know, we can get Daniel in there as a Joker or something, you know.
I need to get a grill for that.
Yeah.
So you guys have any last words for the chat here, Carolyn? Thank you for hanging out.
Yeah, thank you.
Bill and everybody who's been watching us as well, even Bobby who jumped in and jumped out.
Thank you so much.
Dennis, it's a blast. I love coming on and theorizing and speculating about everything that happened and will happen. I I think Cersei is probably going to remain on the throne until the end whenever she squares off with Dany. Mm-hmm. I think it's going to come down between those two queens.
Oh, no. I 100% agree.
You know what my theory is? I think that Arya is going to use some of that mini face play action.
Oh.
And she may pretend to be one of the Lannisters. And get them to turn on each other. I think that's what happens there. I think she might.
She'll pretend to be Jaime.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
can she use Jaime's face even though that face isn't in the hall? How's that work?
That's a good point. I think. Or she could be Tyrion. That might be a thing. You know, yeah. I think Arya's gonna be involved at some point because she definitely has a bone to pick with those Lannisters, those crafty Lannisters there.
That's a really good point. Yeah. I like that because Arya, she's coming back with a vengeance. Mm-hmm. She's coming in hard and
man,
it's
Mountain it's versus nuts. Hound redemption fight.
Yep. Yeah.
I think there's so much to look forward to. We got 7 episodes left that mm-hmm. season. Mm-hmm. I think it's 6 episodes in the final season. So, like you said, Carolyn, no filler, just all you can handle.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's very.
It's gonna be a slobber knocker. Clearly.
What if they BBC this and they end up making each episode like an hour and a half?
Oh my gosh.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, that's true. They haven't actually said how long the episodes will be. Yeah. Just that they're gonna be 7. So, that's a good
we'll
point.
See.
Well,
let's hope.
It's been a great season. Guys, thank you for hanging out with me. We don't have anything else right now. I do have plans on doing another stream in about 20 minutes. We're going to have to switch some things out. But it's been a great show.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking forward to having some more episodes of Gamecast soon, which I'll be talking to you guys about at some point. It's been a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Make an hour and a half happen. You know what? Go ahead and just petition now, Caroline. Okay. If you just like riot a bit, you know, if your pitch works out, you know, I think they'll listen to you. All right. But yes, we do have King of Fight Cake coming up next. We'll be doing some fighting game action with my buddy A Town later on tonight. We're gonna have some fun playing classic fighting games. You know, some Street Fighter Tetris will probably be played later on.
Nice.
You know, some good stuff. So it's gonna be a lot of fun. But, yes, Daniel and Gino, they've been hanging out with me for the entire season. Make sure you guys show them some love. I'm going to post all their stuff on the Twitters.
Yes, on the Twitter pages.
Let's know. We'll repost, share. We'll talk to you guys as well.
Yep.
Even outside of the season. We're here for you guys. We'll be talking to Denny as well.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll see me mainly just sending out a lot of memes with Nicolas Cage.
Sounds about right. Yeah. So to end off the season, I'm gonna show the video I posted earlier as the memorandum for all the lost souls.
Perfect.
So here's a video for you guys. It's just got every death with a Jordan face on it. You know, just Jordan crying. Here we posted in chat for you guys can see it too. So there you go. So you guys can watch along. I'm gonna play on here for the stream. All right, you guys. enjoy yourselves.
Oh my.
There goes Rickon Jordan. Bolton Jordan.
Doran Jordan.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, 1-1.
Rams,
it's been a long year.
It's been a long year.
Crazy devs, but
there's Jordan's hanging. Oh, he said that. So many faces of Jordan now. Oh, yes. There he goes.
Oh, Lancel Jordan.
Yeah. Goodbye, Jordan. And there's
the Septim Taylor.
King's Landing Drake. Goodbye. We've got Fred Jordan.
It's been
the pie of Jordan.
Oh my gosh!
It's been a great season.
Yep, it really has been great. Thanks, Denny, so much for inviting me on your show and our both of us, and I've just had a blast. So,
all right, guys. So that's it. That's it for us.
Awesome, Denny. Thank you.
Yep,
guys. Everyone watching as well. Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Yep.
Thank you for chiming in. We love you guys. We'll be back for more.
Yes, we will.
Yay.
You better believe that Mad Queen's going to come back.